Today I wanted to share with you the unsolved murder of Margaret Martin. She was a resident of Kingston, Pennsylvania, United States, who went missing on December 17th, 1938, decades ago, right? She was found dead in Wyoming County, Pennsylvania, several days later. Now, because it's unsolved, I always find it interesting to share them through YouTube to raise more awareness for these cases, even though they might never be solved, that's true, doesn't really matter. Today I wanted to share with you the details they had on the wiki about this person, so let's get right into it. Now, they wrote the following concerning the victim. Margaret Martin was a resident of Kingston. She graduated from Kingston High School in 1937. She took classes at the Wilkes-Barre Business College to gain secretarial skills and graduated with honors at the beginning of December 1938. She was 19 years old at the time of her death. According to Betty Hopkins, a former classmate, Martin was a shy, studious, friendly girl who had many friends. Her parents described her as a living saint. Martin's father was John Martin, a local foreman and minor politician. Margaret herself was the eldest of four children. So those were the details concerning this person while they were still alive. Now what happened? Well, first she disappeared and then they found her body. On December 17th, 1938, a man contacted Martin, claiming that he was setting up an insurance company and needed a secretary, adding that he had heard of her through the business college. The two agreed to meet in Kingston Corners, not far from her home. She was first noted to be missing that evening after she had failed to return home from the alleged job interview. Several witnesses said they saw her getting into a brown Plymouth or black sedan with a man after a brief conversation. This was the last time she was seen alive. The witnesses were able to give only vague descriptions of the man. They described him as a neat, sandy-haired young man and did not identify the car's license plate. The man was between 25 and 30 years of age and slightly overweight. Martin's friends and family called the police and started a search, but her disappearance was difficult to publicize since the local newspapers were on strike. Well, imagine that, man. The newspapers were on strike, so they don't care about the person that disappeared, right? That sounds bizarre as hell. But then again, it happens a lot with these obscure cases in general. The news doesn't always cover them at great length. That's what we do through Creepy News, even though it doesn't really go along the normal narrative of how I present these cases, and the way I narrate it is kind of crazy, I know. Doesn't really matter, it still serves a purpose. Now, according to a 1999 article in the Times Leader, Martin was tortured and murdered in a sawmill in the mountains about 15 miles from the creek where her body was found. According to theories by the police, the killer had attempted to dismember her body and destroy it in the mill's fire box, but had been scared off by the mill's owner, James Cat. Cat had assumed that the killer was a mere trespasser and had fired a warning shot in the killer's direction. The killer then drove to a point close to the creek and carried Martin's body to the final 75 yards to the creek, where he abandoned it. Initially, it was suspected that her disappearance was linked to a sex slavery ring. However, her body was discovered in a forested wilderness in the north of Wyoming County on December 21st, 1938, about 25 miles from her home. The person who discovered her body was 19-year-old Anthony Rzakowski, who was trapping muskrats in the area. Rzakowski noticed a large burlap bag partially submerged in 2 feet of water in a creek. Upon further investigation, he found the bag to contain the mutilated body of a young woman with no clothing. The body was soon identified as Margaret Martin's. At the time of her body's discovery, she had been dead for at least 24 hours. If not for Rzakowski's discovery of her body, it may have gone unnoticed for several years. Her body showed signs of having been beaten, perhaps with a rock, and strangled. She had bruises on her throat and body, as well as knife wounds on her stomach and thigh. Her autopsy found the cause of death to be strangulation and stated that she had suffered the molestation of a degenerate.
That sounds so fucking weird. What?
Guys, it was a degenerate that killed her. Let's be clear about this. After the discovery of Martin's body, approximately 75 state troopers combed the area in search of clues. However, no tire tracks were seen near the site where her body was found, and the burlap bag proved to be of no use in identifying any suspects. According to the Citizen's Voice, burnt clothing matching the clothing Martin was wearing when she was last seen was discovered at an abandoned sawmill near Forkston. However, an article in the Kane Republican stated that this was not the origin of the cloth. An incident involving a bundle of clothing being thrown from a car proved to be unrelated to Martin's killing. On December 22nd, the Scranton Tribune predicted that Martin's killer would be arrested within 24 hours. Many hundreds of people attended her funeral in Kingston on December 24th. Plainclothes police officers also attended her funeral in the hopes of noticing anyone suspicious attending. Several theories about the identity of Martin's murderer were suggested by locals. These included a mortician from Wyoming County, a businessman's son who left the area soon after the murder, a local assistant pastor, a teacher at the college, and a local teenager who had a crush on Martin. Two men who had attempted to attack a 16-year-old girl from Hanover Township were also investigated. Some investigators believe that due to the killer's familiarity with the area's terrain, the killer must have been a local. More recently, it has been suggested the killer was actually a known local serial killer. On December 28, 1938, Pennsylvania State Senator Leo C. Mundy said he would introduce a bill making sex crimes punishable by execution and requiring registration for all sex offenders. Mundy had resolved to introduce the bill due to Martin's murder. Physicians and welfare social service workers would also be required to report anyone with tendencies towards such offenses. By the beginning of 1939, most clues pertaining to Martin's murder had proven to be useless. The manhunt for the killing was still ongoing in February of that year, but the police had not turned up any more information. In June 1939, further clues were discovered, but the killer was not identified. Although a very large number of suspects were investigated after her murder, no perpetrator was ever identified. In September 1942, Orban Taylor of New York City confessed to her murder. However, his confession was proven to be false after 10 hours of investigation. He was not charged with that crime, although he did confess to several other crimes. In 1948, a decade after her murder, the case was one of the few major unsolved murders in Pennsylvania. In 1999, Peter Paul Olszewski Jr., who was at the time the Luzerne County District Attorney, stated that even with modern criminal investigation methods and forensic techniques, it is unlikely that the identity of Martin's killer will ever be discovered. It is presumed that the killer is now long deceased. Well, that's too bad, right? Because that's true with these cases that are almost 100 years old by now. Odds are that the killer is dead by now. That's sad for the victim, but also for the family of the victim, always had to suffer a long time not knowing who was responsible to what happened to their daughter in this case. It's very sad indeed, so like always we say, I hope the victim is resting in peace, and it is true, the perpetrator probably will never be found, but this way we at least can keep her story alive through YouTube as well. And with that being said, dear viewer, have sweet dreams.